In a recent video, we detailed how there's good evidence leaving 3 to 0 repetitions in reserve produces similar muscle hypertrophy to training to failure. Leaving 0 repetitions in reserve indicates you could not have done another full repetition, while leaving 3 repetitions in reserve indicates you could have performed another 3 full repetitions. Also, we're defining failure as technical failure, the point at which you fail at performing another full repetition with correct execution. This was essentially the definition used in the studies we examined, and for muscle hypertrophy, it makes little sense to deviate from using the correct execution, as doing so would typically not benefit the tension experienced by the muscles you're trying to train. For instance, in a biceps curl, deviating from correct execution via excessively swinging your back will recruit the spinal erector muscles, but this won't enhance elbow flexor recruitment. It might decrease elbow flexor recruitment in certain circumstances. With those clarifications out of the way, as noted, leaving 3 to 0 repetitions in reserve likely produces similar hypertrophy to training to failure. But what about leaving more than 3 repetitions in reserve? Could leaving 4, 5, 6, or even more repetitions in reserve still optimize muscle hypertrophy? By my count, 4 regular longitudinal studies have technically examined how leaving more than 3 repetitions in reserve compares to training to failure for hypertrophy. Let's analyze them. Mortarelli and colleagues allocated 89 previously untrained women into one of 3 groups: a failure, non-failure equal set, or non-failure plus 1 set group. All 3 groups trained the barbell biceps curl twice per week for 10 weeks. The failure group performed their exercise with 3 sets of repetitions to failure with a 70% or 1 rep max load each session. The non-failure equals set group performed 3 sets of 7 repetitions with a 70% or 1 rep max load each session. With a 70% or 1 rep max load on the barbell biceps curl, the data provided in the study suggests subjects could perform a maximum of 12 to 13 repetitions. Meaning this non-failure equal set group would have been leaving roughly 5 to 6 repetitions in reserve on their first set. However, their second and third sets, due to cumulative fatigue, would have probably had them leave roughly 4 to 2 repetitions in reserve. The non-failure plus 1 set group performed 4 sets of 7 repetitions with a 70% or 1 rep max load each session. This group would have also been training with roughly between 6 to 2 repetitions in reserve, the only difference being they performed an extra set per session. All groups rested 2 minutes between their sets in a session. Moreover, 1 rep max was retested on the 5th week to readjust the 70% or 1 rep max training loads used for all groups. By the end of the study, increases in elbow flexor thickness seemed to be greatest for the failure group. Therefore, this study suggests regardless of whether an individual performs the same number of sets, all performers want an extra set, leaving more than 3 repetitions in reserve for the majority of your sets may be inferior for hypertrophy. Do the other studies support this conclusion? Let's find out. The second study by Lasvicius and colleagues assigned 25 previously untrained men into either a high load or low load group. All subjects performed the unilateral leg extension twice per week for 8 weeks. The high load group used an 80% or 1 rep max load. With one leg, which we'll call the high load failure leg, they performed 3 sets of repetitions to failure every session. Ultimately, this leg performed 12 repetitions on average in each set. With their other leg, which we'll call the high load non-failure leg, they performed 60% of the average repetitions achieved each set with a high load failure leg. Moreover, they performed additional sets to equalize the overall volume load, the product of sets times reps times load, to the high load failure leg. Ultimately, this leg performed an average of 5 to 6 sets of 7 repetitions, meaning they would have been leaving an average of 5 repetitions in reserve while performing 2 to 3 extra sets versus the high load failure leg. The low load group used a 30% or 1 rep max load. With one leg, which we'll call the low load failure leg, they performed 3 sets of repetitions to failure every session. Ultimately, this leg performed 34 repetitions on average in each set. With their other leg, which we'll call the low load non-failure leg, they performed 60% of the average repetitions achieved each set with a low load failure leg. and they performed additional sets to equalize the overall volume load to the low load failure leg. Ultimately, this leg performed an average of 5 to 6 sets of 20 repetitions, meaning they would have been leaving an average of 14 repetitions in reserve while performing 2 to 3 extra sets versus the low load failure leg. All subjects rested 2 minutes between their sets in a session. Moreover, one rep max was retested during the 4th week to readjust the 30% and 80% of one rep max training loads used for the respective groups. By the end of the study, except for the low load non-failure leg, all the other legs experienced similar increases in quadriceps cross-sectional area. As a result, given the low load non-failure leg experienced the least growth, this suggests leaving an average of 14 repetitions in reserve may be unable to optimize muscle hypertrophy, despite them performing 2-3 extra sets compared to the failure legs. However, given the high load non-failure leg experienced similar growth to the high load and low load failure legs, this suggests leaving an average of 5 repetitions in reserve might actually be fine for muscle hypertrophy, so long as 2-3 extra sets are performed. Stated another way, performing 5-6 sets while leaving roughly 5 repetitions in reserve may be as effective as performing 3 sets of repetitions to failure. This is interesting. Perhaps on a set equated basis, performing 3 sets of repetitions to failure would be superior to performing 3 sets of leaving 5 repetitions in reserve, as somewhat supported by the Mortarelli study. However, performing extra sets while leaving 5 repetitions in reserve compensates for this. Having said this, the third study by Carlsen and colleagues questions this. 18 men with 2-5 years of training experience were assigned into a failure or non-failure group. Both groups trained a range of exercises twice per week for 6 weeks. The failure group aimed to perform every exercise each session with 4 sets of 10 repetitions to failure, while using 2 minutes of rest between sets. When needed, the load was increased if they could do more than 10 repetitions on a set, or if they could not complete the 10 repetitions, 30 seconds of rest was given to enable them to complete this number. The non-failure group aimed to perform every exercise each session with 8 sets of 5 repetitions that left roughly 5 repetitions in reserve, with 1 minute of rest between sets. When needed, this group adjusted the load each set to maintain roughly 5 repetitions in reserve. By the end of the study, increases in thickness of the vastus medialis and elbow flexors tended to be greater for the failure group, whereas anterior deltoid thickness increases were similar between both groups. As a result, this study conflicts with the Lasvicia study, as it largely suggests despite performing extra sets, 4 in this case, leaving roughly 5 repetitions in reserve was unable to optimize muscle hypertrophy. Why the conflicting findings between these two studies? For one, the Lasvicia study used previously untrained men, while the Carlsen study used men with 2-5 years of training experience. Maybe this implies leaving 5 repetitions in reserve and performing extra sets only works in untrained individuals and not those with greater training experience. Secondly, as we noted, if the failure group in the Carlsen study could not complete 10 repetitions on a set, they were given a 30-second break to enable them to then achieve this number. This is somewhat like rest-pause training. Frustratingly, the researchers did not state how frequently subjects did this, but if it was frequent, perhaps this could somehow explain the conflicting results between the two studies, as the Lasvicia study merely had the failure groups perform their repetitions to failure, nothing more, nothing less. Thirdly, in the Lasvicia study, all subjects rested 2 minutes between their sets in a session. Opposingly, the Carlsen study had the failure group rest 2 minutes between sets and the non-failure group rest only 1 minute between sets. This potentially confounds the Carlsen study, as it's likely resting for 2 minutes between sets is better than resting for 1 minute between sets for hypertrophy, at least with compound exercises. Therefore, the largely inferior results for the non-failure group might not necessarily be because they left 5 repetitions in reserve, rather because they only rested 1 minute between sets. Unfortunately, it's difficult to say which of these 3 explanations. Was it down to the differences in training experience, the potential rest-pause style in the Carlsen study, or rest intervals that explains the conflicting findings of the Lasvesius and Carlsen studies. More research is undoubtedly required. The last regular longitudinal study I'm aware of that has examined how leaving more than 3 repetitions in reserve compares to training to failure comes from Carroll and colleagues. 15 men with an average of 7.7 years of training experience were allocated into a relative intensity or rep max group. Both groups trained 3 times per week for 10 weeks. Quite an intricate periodized training plan was used for both groups. The link to the full study can be found in the description for those after more details, but I'll simplify the main points. Both groups performed the same exercises, mainly compound exercises with some isolation work, for the same number of sets and roughly the same number of repetitions. The rep max group used rep max loads for their sets. For example, they may have performed an exercise for 3 sets of 8 to 12 repetitions with a 10 repetition maximum load. The researchers stated this group reached failure on the last set of each exercise. Moreover, I think it's probably likely that other sets would have left 3 or fewer repetitions in reserve, which we know is fine for muscle hypertrophy. The relative intensity group used around 70 to 90% of the rep max loads for an exercise. For instance, if someone in the relative intensity group could perform 3 sets of 8 to 12 repetitions with a 100 kg load on an exercise, and this 100 kg load was their 10 rep max load, using an 85% relative intensity resulted in them performing 3 sets of 8 to 12 repetitions with an 85 kg load. Based on some calculations, this relative intensity group would have been leaving around 2 to 6 repetitions in reserve on 2 of the training days per week, and between 4 to 14 repetitions in reserve on the third day of each week. By the end of the study, increases in vastus lateralis anatomical cross-sectional area favored the relative intensity group. In other words, with all other training variables equal, largely leaving more than 3 repetitions in reserve, which is what the relative intensity group did, was more favorable for growth compared to training 2 or closer to failure, which is what the rep max group did. Having said this, there is a potential confounding factor in this study. Both groups performed additional sprint training twice per week. Training to failure is more fatiguing than leaving repetitions in reserve, and thus added sprint training may have impaired the rep max group's recovery capacity, thereby possibly explaining why they experienced suboptimal growth versus the relative intensity group. If true, perhaps this study indicates if an individual performs additional high intensity training, like sprint training, or frequent cardiovascular training sessions of any type, leaving more than 3 repetitions in reserve might be better for managing fatigue and thus promoting muscle growth. Although, I still feel more research is needed to verify this. I think it'd be useful to see simpler and cleaner designed studies comparing muscle growth between training with various proximities to failure, such as 3 repetitions in reserve, 5 repetitions in reserve, or failure training, while all subjects perform additional cardio or high intensity training. In summary, Mortarelli and colleagues indicate with all other training variables equal, largely leaving more than 3 repetitions in reserve does not optimally build muscle in previously untrained women. Lasvesius and colleagues indicate that provided an individual performs 2 to 3 more sets for an exercise than usual, leaving an average of 5 repetitions in reserve can build muscle optimally in previously untrained men. However, a study by Carlson and colleagues suggests in men with 2 to 5 years of training experience, despite performing 4 extra sets, leaving 5 repetitions in reserve largely failed to optimize muscle growth, although there were some confounders in this study. Finally, Carroll and colleagues indicate when an individual performs additional sprint training sessions, training with more than 3 repetitions in reserve may be superior for promoting muscle growth compared to training 2 or closer to failure with all other training variables equal. Overall, it's clear to see this current evidence is limited, somewhat conflicting, and overall far from clear. As a result, we unfortunately cannot conclude if leaving more than 3 repetitions in reserve can optimize muscle hypertrophy. Now, for those who have seen our previous video in which we detailed how the current research indicates leaving 3 to 0 repetitions in reserve is similarly effective to training to failure for muscle hypertrophy, you may recall at the end of this video, I stated there's some velocity-based research that indicates leaving more than 3 repetitions in a reserve may be able to optimize muscle growth. However, after recently digging a lot more into this research and even planning a whole 6,000 word video on it, I eventually realized that this research has far too many considerations and practical limitations. More specifically, due to the design of the studies, a lot of math and extrapolation was required to figure out the repetition in reserve numbers, which ultimately made it very inaccurate, such that it's not entirely clear what repetition in reserve numbers was used in those studies. As a result, I came to the conclusion it was not worth detailing this research. On the basis of this, as well as the research detailed in this video, because it's simply unclear if leaving more than 3 repetitions in reserve can still optimize muscle hypertrophy, I think it's probably best to err on the side of caution and aim to leave 3 or fewer repetitions in reserve if your aim is to build muscle as best as you can.